Okay, if everybody would, Dennis, do you need 5 minutes, did you say? What? What? Oh, fine. Okay, well, thank you so much. Hope you enjoy the lunch. Our next speaker, of course, is Michael Shaw from freedomadvocates.org. And Michael will be talking on the environmental movement, this organized effort to destroy the infrastructure of our society and convert us into an agrarian type of society, at least those people who are to be remain. Because going along with Agenda 21, which he speaks about, is a population control agenda that really wants to eliminate most of the people in the world. So without further ado, Michael Sidney retired. I gave up a very prosperous a business to spend full time trying to educate the American people about what's going on. He's the leading expert on Agenda 21 and the environmental movement. Without further ado, Michael Shaw.
Thank you. Well, I think a year makes a difference. American people are starting to really wake up. And I think that has the advocates of globalism on the run, which means their pressures are going to accelerate, which means the need to understand what we're up against also grows. That's why I'm here today, is to help you with a new perspective on what Agenda 21 is. I call it globalism through regionalism. Throughout history, government owned the citizenry. Some forms of authority were violent, others managed the people to the benefit of the rulers. No society recognized the value of the sovereignty of the individual until 1776. America was the exception to centralized authority. That is our heritage. The foundation of America rests on the political recognition of each individual's natural or unalienable rights. Today, that recognition is lacking. Resurrecting that idea is why Freedom Advocates exists. Valuing life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, coupled with an honest monetary system predicated on the practices of a moral citizenry, produced a society where individuals were free to pursue their own lives. We all gain in a voluntary, free society. Free enterprise grows standards of living and advances human achievement. The challenge today is how do we restore this? Woefully, our government has abandoned its commitment to the protection of unalienable rights and to natural law. We have lost our commitment to honest money, and as a consequence, America flounders. Instead, a new philosophy with an accompanying action plan has been inserted, one that intends for humans to take on the status of livestock. The point is that power has been allowed to aggregate and grow. Our political and economic systems are controlled by a globalist monetary system that intends to create a one-world governance dynamic. Already equipped with an international framework that includes the United Nations, the World Bank, the World Trade Organization, and the Bank of International Settlements, a new political economic order is well advanced. Today, the globalist objective is to work at the local level to advance this new world system that intends to control all human action. The globalists have a plan. The plan is called Agenda 21, Sustainable Development. Now, in their own words, Agenda 21 is a comprehensive plan for the restructure of society and the remake of man. Sustainable development is a communitarian program that is designed to transform man into the globalist ideal of the new man. This concept sees man as an obedient serf answering to a ruling oligarchy. Today, I am going to describe the regional aspect of Agenda 21. Globalism has always sought to implement itself through political regionalism. Today, we are going to examine the layer of regional governance designed to advance sustainable development in America. Sustainable development policy has infiltrated almost everything. In that regard, it is worth noting that the Grand Old Party is a member of the International Democrat Union. The IDU is comprised of 80 self-described right-of-center political parties from around the world. They combine in order to dedicate to the universal adoption of the United Nations Universal Declaration of Human Rights. Under the UN system, all law is man-made. Nothing is immutable. George Bush Sr. and Governor Haley Barbour of Mississippi represent the American leadership at the IDU. This is a webpage from the IDU. You can see that it says there that being committed to advancing the social and political values on which democratic societies are founded, including the basic personal freedoms and human rights as defined in the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. This is the principal statement from the IDU. Now, all political parties are committed to globalism. So this invites the question, particularly in the light of the purpose of the IDU. And that question is, which philosophy of rights do we intend our society to abide by? We can either adopt the U.S. system of individual rights, as enunciated in the U.S. Declaration of Independence, where the purpose of government is to protect the natural or unalienable rights of the individual, that all men are created equal, and that they are endowed by their Creator with certain unalienable rights. Let's contrast that with the globalist concept of community rights, which is expressed in the UN Declaration of Human Rights. There, control of the individual for the good of the greater community is the purpose of government. In Article 29 of that document, it actually says, "The rights and freedoms may be in no case exercised contrary to the purposes and principles of the United States, of the United Nations." So you see a direct contrast in the philosophical underpinnings between the American experience and the globalist expression. And yet, past presidents of the United States say that this is the document to which all Americans will pledge their future allegiance. Why isn't he in jail as a traitor? You see, under the IDU and under the UN, government grants, withdraws, and respects your, and it grants, withdraws, and restricts your rights depending upon its needs. You and the product of your labor belong to the community. Let's go back and contrast that with the American experiment, where you're born with rights, and government exists only to protect those rights. You and the product of your labor, therefore, belong to you. There are three broad principles that underlie Agenda 21. The first is the step-by-step abolition of private property. Second is education for global citizenship. Do you think the notion of unalienable rights is presented in today's schools? Take notice of the number of young sustainablers, many of whom identify themselves as global citizens. Universities are building a fifth column for sustainability. an army of young college graduates, some of them with degrees in sustainability. For even younger people, there are the policies and assessments of No Child Left Behind. All of this is geared to neuter the next generation's understanding of liberty and of the American experience. While our schools train our children to become global governance slaves, the third driving principle of Agenda 21 is control over human action. For instance, we see technological advances used by government to monitor the individual. We see this happening through federal legislation that would direct biometric identification of you embedded within your driver's license. We see the advent of cameras everywhere, of internet health records, of TSA body grabbers, and government accessible databases that possess everything about you that you now think is private. In short, sustainable development is about assessing, monitoring, and controlling. Think about smart electrical meters. Talk about managing and controlling us. This is why policy for decades has been driving us toward shortages, including the arrived at shortages of electricity and water. Policy coupled with technology has made possible the attainment of centralized management control over resources and individual action. Smart water is right around the corner. We in this country, and certainly in this state, and particularly in this county, have turned our back on water development. Available water supply has been managed in order to create the shortage that we are now experiencing and that will increasingly be felt by us all. I'm going to focus my comments on the first objective of Agenda 21 to abolish private property concerning land. Now, most Americans live in a city, but what happens in the rural lands matters to all of us. The origin of everything we have, everything in this building, the origin, the resources came from the rural lands of America. The consequences of what happens in rural America ultimately falls upon each of us and everybody in urban centers. Do people in the city really believe in private property in land? If so, now is the time to come to the aid of rural landowners in this state and throughout the United States. Now, to understand what is at issue here, we have to understand what private property is. Private property includes your person. My hands are my private property. Your thoughts are your private property. And so is your relationship to something. And by relationship, I mean the power to use and enjoy that thing. Private property is not the object. It's my ability to use and control and to benefit from that object. So private property includes living on and working land to the benefit of oneself and or a waiting market. The fiat money system, that is money that comes from thin air, undermines the notion of private property because it erases free enterprise as capitalism methodically establishes public-private partnerships. While lip service is being paid to preserving the family farm, independent farmers are herded to sell to major corporate interests or to conservation groups like the Nature Conservancy. As America implements Agenda 21's land use programs called Smart Growth and the Wildlands Network, recognition of unalienable rights is obliterated. Let me explain these programs with the help of this map. the simulated reserve and corridor system to protect biodiversity, the new key internationalist term these days, as required by the UN Convention on Biological Diversity, Wildlands Project, the UN and US Man in the Biosphere programs, and the World Heritage programs as a vital step in attaining sustainable development. Let me define a couple of terms relevant to this map. First, wildlands. Wildlands is the removal of people and the prohibition of resource extraction. These areas are included in this map, on this map, in red. This is why we can't tap our oil. This is why we can't cut our forests, even the dead forests. I was in Montana talking about the conditions harming plants. In Montana, 50% of the standing trees are dead, and they can't cut them down. The fires that are going to hit Montana are going to be overwhelming. Now, the yellow areas in this map are buffers to the wildlands where public-private partners will engage in limited and controlled activities. Well, that's the whole country. So where do we go? Well, let's talk about smart growth. Now, smart growth, you know, the burning passion throughout the state, the longtime pursuit of the Santa Cruz County government, is the stacking and packing of human beings in dense cities where people will depend on public transportation rather than automobility. Smart growth areas, also referred to by the UN as human settlements, are demonstrated by the black dots concentrated on the coastlines, a few black dots in the interior of the United States. If you're living somewhere else, expect to be relocated. Now, the Wildlands Network, operating here in California, is helping to create and implement policies and legislation that promote massive land grabs. The land policy of the United Nations was first officially articulated at the UN Conference on Human Settlements in Vancouver, Canada, back in 1976. This quote is from the preamble of the UN policy on land. Quote, "Land cannot be treated as an ordinary asset, controlled by individuals and subject to the pressures and inefficiencies of the market. Private land ownership is a principal instrument in accumulation and concentration of wealth and therefore contributes to social injustice. If unchecked, it may become a major obstacle in the planning and implementation of development schemes. Public control of land use is therefore indispensable." The Wildlands Network is being implemented at all levels of American government and is designed to serve the UN's objective in regard to land and resources. Private property and freedom are inseparable. George Washington first said that, and now we can look at the kinds of signs that are appearing on roads throughout the West in these so-called wildland areas as road after road after road is closed. Right down the street here, south of La Selva Beach, is this sign, the National Wildlife Refuge. Authorized entry prohibited. There's rumor there's some long-toed salamanders in there, and you aren't allowed. Area behind this sign is closed, all public entry prohibited. In small print, you know, what that really means is if you're with the government, you can get in. This open space areas will become more and more restricted until eventually we're going to see signs like this everywhere. What I'm going to do is shift the focus to what drives the globalist transition. So we're going to examine regionalism. Now, regionalism is a very important political concept. Regionalism has overtaken California. the large-scale version of modern regionalism is a federally imposed, extra-constitutional layer of government covering the entire nation. Regionalism might sound benign, but the consequences must be understood by freedom-loving people, or liberty will be trampled. Regionalism is being used to destroy traditional political boundaries like county lines and usher in a transformed system of governance that abolishes private property, a goal of sustainable development, Agenda 21. Now, according to the website called NARC, anybody ever heard of NARC? I'm not talking about the drug enforcement people. I'm talking about the National Association of Regional Councils. Seriously, has anybody ever heard of it? No. Well, NARC themselves say, we serve as the national voice of regionalism through effective interaction and advocacy with Congress, federal officials, and other gate agencies and interest groups. Well, what do? They just do a few things. They deal with transportation, community and economic development, the environment, homeland security, regional preparedness, and community issues. NARC's members include the following regional planning and development agencies: so-called councils of governments, also known as COGs, and metropolitan planning organizations, so-called MPOs. So what is a council of government, this COG? Well, COGs are region-wide associations of local governments, regional bodies typically defined to serve an area of several counties to address issues such as regional and municipal planning, economic and community development, cartography and GIS, hazard mitigation and emergency planning, aging services, water use, pollution control, transit administration, and transportation planning. Now, how many people have heard of COGS? One, two, three, four people? COGS are sometimes also called regional councils. Now, here's a map of regional councils in the United States. So you know they have good coverage of all the areas, and they have absolute control over everything your local government can do. So what's an MPO? An MPO, or a Metropolitan Planning Organization, is an agency created by federal law to provide local input for urban transportation planning and allocating transportation funds to cities larger than 50,000. Well, MPOs are federally mandated, and like COGS, they give opportunity for restructuring of American government. They are setting an infrastructure for a new economic system based on public-private partnership in replacement of free enterprise. Now, COGS and MPOs are federalized organizations that break down America's constitutionally formulated governmental structure. Their purpose is to control and direct local government from behind the scenes. Today, they propel federal injection of the globalist agenda into local government policy and thereby negate the protections afforded by our constitutional system of government. In the words of Charlotte Iserby, the former Department of Education official and author of The Deliberate Dumbing Down of America, she says, regionalism is communism. Well, regionalism can also form the basis for a fascist economy. Regionalism erases political boundaries and thus representative government. Nobody ever voted for anybody sitting on the COG. As a COG member, they may have voted for them as a city council person, but citizens don't even know these organizations exist. And our eighth graders, if there is a civics class in your schools, and most schools don't have a civics class anymore, but in those civics classes that do exist, nobody ever learned about the regional level of American government. You see, regional governance cannot coexist with the American Republic form of government. CalCOG, the California Association of Council of Governments. This organization serves as a forum for local governments to prepare regional plans and to set regional policy, to develop and maintain regional databases. CalCOG also works for the regional coordination and policy development between cities and counties. And you thought you were in charge of your Board of Supervisors and your city council people. This is who they really answer to. Now, CalCOG is a Soviet-style council that develops policy that is then rubber-stamped by elected officials with no meaningful public oversight. It is an extra-constitutional level of government that advances globalist objectives while insulating most elected officials. In short, CalCOG exists to advance the globalist goals of regionalizing, to implement a step-by-step approach to the abolition of private property, to promote the relocation of people from wildlands and corridor areas to smart growth areas, and for the conscription of public-private partners, the mandatory volunteers of the new fifth column. The government in America no longer operates the way your eighth grade textbook explained it. People know that a Soviet system of government is a dismal failure. A failure so bad, in fact, that it's inconceivable to consider that Soviet-style change agents might actually be Americans living and working in your neighborhood. Even worse would be to discover that your smiling political leaders might also be agents of change. In fact, there is this whole Soviet system of councils, including MPOs and COGs, that is directing your local government. So what does Soviet mean? Well, a Soviet is a system of councils that report to an apex council and that implement a predetermined outcome affecting a region or neighborhood. It is often arranged through a facilitated consensus process. Members of a Soviet are chosen by virtue of their willingness to comply with the group and their one-mindedness with that objective. Soviets are the operating mechanism of a government-controlled economy, whether it is socialism or public-private partnerships. A Soviet is a system of interconnected councils that work to destroy individual personality, suppress individual potential, and consolidate power into the hands of those who seek to control human action and production. This is the latest report of the regional Soviet's progress toward changing our system of government through sustainability. 2010, the California Regional Progress Report, One State, Many Regions, Our Future, tracking progress toward sustainability. You see, Agenda 21 is very organized. We've got a good ways to go before we begin to catch up with them, and now is the time to get that in high gear. Every state has some form of regional organization like CalCOG. It may not be a COG, it may be an MPO. The scary part is that organizations like CalCOG are throughout the country, but the battle is always local. How many children know of this system of government? I'd venture to say none. This is the de facto system. Why do we put up with an illegitimate government designed to erase political boundaries? In the state of Massachusetts, counties have been eliminated. Regional governance has formally and fully taken its place. Now let's examine another important aspect of the local Agenda 21 action plan. That is the organization called ICLEI. I imagine this audience is fairly familiar with ICLEI. How many people know about ICLEI? Good. Well, ICLEI is the International Council for Local Environmental Initiatives. It also goes by the name Local Governments for Sustainability. ICLEI is the most vulnerable globalist organization operating in America today, simply because they are a UN partner working under contract with your local government and working with your regional Soviet. This is the local Agenda 21 planning guide, which was prepared in the early 90s by the ICLEI organization. This sets out the steps that ICLEI undergoes for transitioning communities. ICLEI, in their own words, is an international association of local governments implementing sustainable development. ICLEI's mission is to build and serve a worldwide movement of local governments to achieve tangible improvements in global environmental and sustainable conditions through cumulative local actions. You see, we can't wait for Washington, D.C. to ride in and save us. I mean, they're not that anyone should think they're going to. But the real problem is right here in home. It's where Santa Cruz County and Santa Cruz City and the city of Watsonville have contracts with this organization. And people in Santa Cruz wonder why we're headed the direction we're headed. Now, ICLEI is an important NGO that uses the fraud of man-made global warming and climate change as a scare tactic and a legislative tool. What happens is this. ICLEI works with federally created regional organizations, CalCOG or the local COGs, and it works with other NGOs and partnering private businesses to achieve local sustainable development objectives. An example of this would be ICLEI's work on the Climate Protection Manual for Cities. This manual, this particular manual, was based upon what has been done by ICLEI in the past. This one was developed by the Natural Capitalism Solutions, a private partner working with the globalist entities to bring about the ICLEI dynamic. Goes on to say, ICLEI and Global Energy Center for Community Sustainability, that's what this is all about. The manual follows ICLEI's Cities for Climate Protection campaign with a five-step methodology. You might notice at the bottom of the screen it says the energy and water efficiency by smart metering. Coming from ICLEI, everything we're objecting to comes from ICLEI, is operated and controlled by this ICLEI organization and the politicians that make ICLEI viable in community after community. But this next comment, we didn't write this. This comes from them. The aim of smart meters is to change consumers' behavior. You will not take long showers. You will not use your oven. You will not use your dryer. And they want to have the pin to be able to pull off your smart appliances your use when they want to stop you from using it. That's what smart metering is all about. So who is this Natural Capitalism Solutions? What an oxymoron. Well, their mission statement says that Natural Capitalism Solutions' mission is to educate decision makers in business, government, and civil society, be careful of that, about the principles of sustainability. Not only does ICLEI use climate fraud as their excuse to propel their programs, ICLEI has formed an international congress with city, your city, and county representatives as members. This Congress acts today as a shadow world government. ICLEI directs community planning, departments, and other local agencies and provide statutory and regulatory provisions that implement globalist sustainable policy locally. Until recently, local tax funds paid the contract fee. The new scam that we're seeing from all across the country is that now cities claim that they have stopped paying the contract fee. Well, I don't know if that's true or not. The County Council of Santa Cruz, Dana McCrea, says we've stopped paying our fees. We've gotten those reports from all over the place. We're not paying the fees anymore. Well, the fees were never that big in the first place. The programs and policies don't go away whether they pay the fees or not. And after all, the fees can easily be paid. ICLEI is established and run by the Rockefeller Trust. That's where most of their financing comes from. And when they drop the city fee payment requirements, it just puts a little bigger dent in Rockefeller's pocket. But that's the nature of what it is we're dealing with at the local level when ICLEI policies come to town. Here's an international map of ICLEI offices. The World Secretariat is in Bonn, Germany. There are offices in the US, a new office in Boston, and the traditional office from Berkeley has moved to Oakland. Did that under Jerry Brown. Each ICLEI's city's influence, this is where it gets really bad, is expanded as ICLEI then automatically steers policy at regional boards of transportation and water. In addition, ICLEI policies may infect many other regional transformational governance apparatus, such as the California Air Resources Board, ICLEI's all over inside that organization, the California Coastal Commission, the California Association of Councils of Governments, CalCOG, which we talked about, the Association of Bay Area Governments, ABAG, which we will talk about, the Association of Monterey Bay Area Governments, AMBAG, which we'll also talk about, as well as the Sierra Conservancy, which is locking down the Sierra Mountains for wildland protections. Now, Article 1, Section 10 of the U.S. Constitution makes the following prohibition. No state may enter into any treaty, alliance, or confederation with a foreign entity. Neither may a city. So we've got to ask, is it treasonous for city leaders to contract with ICLEI, an international NGO accredited by the United Nations for the purpose of implementing Agenda 21 and participating in a World Congress? Yes. I don't think there's any question about that, the answer to that question. We have a lot of traitors in office all through America today, and if that doesn't change, we become serfs. Now, the Bay Area has the largest number of ICLEI members for any similarly sized geography in the world. Of the 600 ICLEI cities and counties in America, 178 are in California and 90 are in the Bay Area. Conrad Otto Zimmerman, the Secretary General of ICLEI, says, the United Nations may become the United Cities. That's what our mayor in Santa Cruz is all up to. For a list of ICLEI's U.S. and international members, go to the members section of the ICLEI website at www.icLEI.org. Contracts with ICLEI guarantee implementation of the political and economic policy at the local level, drive city alliances with ICLEI out of the communities surrounding you. Because if you live in Capitola and you say, well, we're not a ICLEI city, you are an ICLEI subject because ICLEI controls AMBAG, and AMBAG controls the city of Capitola. So much of the Agenda 21 invasion at the local level relies upon the man-made global warming fraud. But the unraveling of this masquerade is beginning to hit the local political scene. ICLEI is particularly vulnerable because of general public awareness concerning the man-made warming fraud. Now is the time to get rid of ICLEI. The number of communities with citizens working to remove ICLEI is expanding as citizens begin to tie the links between ICLEI, Agenda 21, and the loss of their freedom. More than a dozen cities in the last months have kicked ICLEI out. That campaign needs to accelerate. To date, no Bay Area town has thrown ICLEI out. Amador County, up in the East Foothills, east of Sacramento, has thrown ICLEI out. A number of cities all around the country have done the same. Wouldn't it be nice if Santa Cruz followed? Yes. Yes. I've broken this talk into two parts. And in about 5 or 10 minutes, we'll get to the second part. We'll just take a couple-minute break when we get there. But before we do that, I want to talk about the major ongoing congressional breaches of the Constitution. These breaches are what's laying the foundation for globalism in America. The first breach is federal ownership and/or management of broad landscapes. Implementation of the Wildlands Network is a violation of Article 1, dealing with the legislative branch, Section 8, dealing with legislative powers of the U.S. Constitution. The federal government, under Article 1, Section 8, has no authority to own or manage areas of land. No authority. In fact, expressly prohibited. The Constitution, you see, was written to protect the unalienable rights of the people, not for government to abrogate them. The Wildlands Network works to abrogate unalienable rights, not to protect them. Congress needs to get its head straight on this issue. The second issue is the delegation of trade policy to international institutions. Now, Congress has delegated authority over U.S. trade policy to the World Trade Organization and to various multilateral trade pact organizations. This abrogates national sovereignty. The effects of surrendering trade policy control include a disintegrating border, constitutional taxing authority under Article 1, Section 9 becomes neutered, American industries are lost to the globalization process, average American earner wages are reduced to global norms. That's the whole objective of globalism. We're all just equal serfs on the plantation. And finally, multinational corporations profit from cheap, often slave labor from overseas. American involvement in the World Trade Organization is designed to destroy the nation. And the third congressional breach, and perhaps the biggest of them all, is the delegation of monetary authority. Another congressional long-standing abrogation of their constitutional responsibilities is the delegation of monetary responsibilities to a globalist system of central banks, resulting in the loss of a constitutional and honest monetary system. This action provides the indispensable ingredient for creating world government. Congress has no authority to delegate an exclusive monetary system to a third party. The current monetary system is designed to cause a financial collapse, which allows the opportunity to further consolidate and strengthen globalist power. The collapse of the monetary system appears to be in process now. So, we need to do a few things. We need to cause federal lands to become private property or state lands. We need to reestablish an American trade policy in D.C. And we must abolish the current fiat monetary system. Each of these constitutional breaches is a pillar upon which globalism is constructed. The American people's goal must be to recapture the federal government. But how do we do that? Not easily. To get there, the battle we can and must win soon is the local battle. To win the local war, you must learn your area's local Agenda 21 program, which we will explore for Central California in part two. The pattern that you will see evidenced in Central California is the same pattern in operation everywhere. I want to take a couple minute break. You know, if you go to the bathroom, fine. But it's long, it's hot, and it's been a long day. So let's just take 2 or 3 minutes and stretch, and we'll rejoin shortly. Thank you. You can learn to recognize the local and broader patterns and tenets of Agenda 21. This way, you, along with a rising number of other freedom-oriented people from across the country, can fight Agenda 21 with insight, starting where the attack all around you is happening and where it is that you can win, and that is at the local level. I recommend that you go to freedomadvocates.org regularly and check out the town crier to learn about upcoming events, as well as to learn about efforts to fight back against Agenda 21 coming in from all over the country and around the world. The globalist invasion has occurred right under our noses. Every county in America has its local Agenda 21 implementation underway. What I am going to do for the next 45 minutes or so is demonstrate the operation of Agenda 21 in Santa Cruz, the Bay Area, and Central California generally. We'll examine an interlinked web of public-private partners driving a new political economic system into these areas. What you will learn is that regionalism is the blueprint for your serfdom. Let's take a look at an excerpt from the United Nations Agenda 21. This is from the Earth Summit, where Agenda 21 was released, the United Nations Program for Action, Chapter 7, dealing with human settlements, promoting transport systems. Now, Agenda 21 tells its member NGOs and governments, etc., that international organizations should promote the comprehensive planning approach, encourage development that reduces transport demand, adopt programs favoring high occupancy public transport, encourage non-motorized modes of transportation by building cycleways and footpaths all around. Have we seen that here in Central California?
Yes.
Your town is adopting these transport system plans. This is because these systems are imposed upon locales by a regional level of government largely unknown, and when known, always underestimated. Your representatives need to understand who they represent, how the American system of government is designed, and how Agenda 21 is designed to change that system and to take control over all human action. Then, those politicians must be held accountable. Under the direction of ICLEI, the regional organizations, including the abundance of NGOs and other public-private partnerships, are planning now how it is you will live. And this is not in any far off time. They're talking about doing this soon. In fact, they're already doing it. under the direction. Well, let's take a look at some of the regional players. I'm going to talk about the Association of Bay Area Governments and the Association of Monterey Bay Area Governments. How many people have some familiarity with these organizations? Okay, it's good. For those who haven't, you're going to get a head full. ABAG and AMBAG are councils of government, part of CALCOG. They are members of CALCOG. This is a map of metropolitan planning organizations and regional transportation planning agencies. It is also the CALCOG map. This is what CALCOG looks like when we don't look at our state as a function of counties. Instead, we look at it as a function of federal regional jurisdictions. Now, ABAG, the Association of Bay Area Governments, is the regional planning agency for 9 counties and 101 cities. ABAG's planning and service programs work to address regional economic, social, and environmental changes. That's standard Agenda 21 claptrap. You see, ABAG is running all Bay Area towns. It dictates major zoning decisions, infrastructure decisions, and more. The organization focus is an organization that's led by ABAG. It also includes the Metropolitan Transportation Commission, the Bay Area Air Quality Management District, and the Bay Conservation and Development Commission. These are in partnership with local governments throughout the Bay Area. Did you know when you elected your city council person, he was going into partnership with federal agencies that are going to tell him what to do? What'd you bother to elect him for? Now, FOCUS, led by ABAG, is a regional development and conservation strategy that promotes a more compact land use pattern in the Bay Area. Compact land use pattern. That's the definition of smart growth. Stack them and pack them. FOCUS unites the efforts of 4 regional agencies into a single program that links land use and transportation by encouraging development of, this is a quote from them, complete livable communities in areas serviced by transit. Okay, that's prototypical smart growth. And they go on to say, we promote the conservation of the region's most significant resource lands. That's the prototypical wildlands. And we're going to talk about Bay Area wildlands a little bit later. Now, regional planning is a very major tax spending investment. It is an investment in central planning. Now, ABAG has its energy programs. You see, they don't just run the cities. ABAG Green Communities in partnership with PG&E means they run PG&E. Energy Upgrade California, Department of Energy Better Buildings Program, and electric vehicle projects. You see, those people who want to break down the American system of government are in control. And it evidences itself through activities such as ABAG power. So this is regionalism in action. There is no accountability by ABAG to anybody, and most citizens are even unaware of its existence. So ABAG says it's in the power business. What kind of service do you think you're going to get? Well, I have an answer. Shortage by design. In fact, this is another, you can see ABAG webpage. When the power goes out. You see, if you don't conserve, the power is going to go out. They're telling us. If you do conserve, the power is going to go out. We need to expose solutions other than the 2 that are presented by ABAG. Conserve, don't conserve, power goes out. This is from ABAG's newsletter called Service Matters. And it's all about completing greenhouse gas emission information. And what they say in their newsletter is that, quote, as a next step, ABAG, ICLEI is married to these regional outfits all across the country, and PG&E, our three best friends, are preparing local governments for community-wide greenhouse gas emissions. That means you're going to be monitored. That's what the smart meter is all about. And this program starts next January. These inventories will be collected by monitoring individuals and households, by monitoring how the monitoring method will be through smart meters. They're going to know what you'd use, how you use it, when you use it, and then they're going to tell you what you can do after that. It is this process that is why utility bills are in the midst of rapidly advancing unit costs in order to implement PG&E's purpose realignment. Once we are monitored, we will be controlled. What does smart mean? Well, here's PG&E's definition. Smart, S means specific, a defined level of program progress, meaning those of you who don't progress are going to have the consequence. Measurable, all results can be tracked by our staff. Actionable, action can be taken on reported progress or its failure. Relevant, direct measurements of program activities and results. I mean, you're being monitored, and timely, we'll have the results quick so we can do something about it. This is an acronym from PG&E's Green Communities letter, January of last year. Now, water policy is going through the same smart approach. We could have a whole lecture on water policy. I'm just going to boil it down to one piece of evidence to demonstrate the pressure that water policy is under. The Santa Cruz Integrated Regional Water Management. Now, this is the latest in a string of solutions for collectivizing water in this county. You know, the one good thing in the state of California is that California followed Texas with its water law, the only perfected water laws in the history of the world. And when I say perfected, I mean water is treated like all other assets. If it's under your ground, it belongs to the overlying land user. That's how water stays private, and that's how water stays available to all of us, because once you put water under a centralized authority, an authority that wants to reduce population, the easiest way to do it is allocate water. That's why it's crucial that citizens like ourselves who live in the rural areas control the water resource. Well, the Santa Cruz Integrated Regional Water Management Program is designed to sacrifice the individual for the collective good. That's what the Integrated Regional Water Management Program is all about. Now, the Soquel Creek Water Management District head, Laura Brown, has been a longtime leader in the integrated regional push to collectivize water. In general, what they want to do is put all the water agencies under one common authority and have that authority control all water, private land or not. Here, there, and everywhere. So we've got another big fight coming, and that's going to be over water. What we do on electrical issues will set the pattern for what we can do in water. Never asked this question before. Anybody know what a B corporation is? Somebody must have been reading Freedom Advocates. It's good. B corporations are going to become big news. B corporations rule out a new economic system that uses social manipulation to destroy free enterprise. We're talking about a new American system of economics where insiders pick the winners and losers. Today's government operates like the clique at junior high school. Cool is in, everyone else is out. Just this month, Governor Brown signed AB 361, a bill that will ultimately wipe out independent and free and private businesses in California. AB 361 establishes California B Corp benefit corporations, a program for buddies and beneficiaries who agree, by requirement of the statute, to advance the principles of sustainable development, Agenda 21. Benefit corporations known as B Corps are a new type of corporation and business sector that purports to, quote, use the power of business to solve social and environmental problems. In reality, these corporations support the implementation of Agenda 21 Sustainable Development, which is based on the three objectives known as the three E's. These corporations have to pursue economy on the basis of public-private partnership. They must promote the environment, which means putting earth before man. And they must promote equity, meaning social engineering. Other terms for the same objectives are people, planet, and profit, or the triple bottom line. Now, B Corps are legally recognized by government for their willingness to undertake Agenda 21 sustainable objectives. State and local entities will be encouraged to allow these companies to go to the front of the line for licenses, permits, and tax incentives. The companies that refuse to become benefit corporations will have to simply wait in line. Those who do not practice sustainability will be excluded. Of course, eventually it will be the big companies that get the favors from government by going along with Agenda 21 sustainability practices, including the idea of benefit corporations. Now, government uses these elite businesses to accomplish their social engineering ideals and to acquire more power without having to answer to voters. B corporations were created by B Labs. The company will support B Labs' public policy objectives, as well as incentives for certified. Now you get to be certified sustainable businesses. This is about creating incentives for buddies and beneficiaries of the new economic order to indicate the establishment of global governance policies into our state legislature. Take note of the B Corporation's Declaration of Interdependence. Interdependence. Now, that's a new term to most people. But I can tell you that if you are a third grader in Santa Cruz schools, you are told that it's become an interdependent world, and that's why the Declaration of Independence is no longer relevant. Remember that term, Declaration of Interdependence. Now that Governor Brown has signed this legislation, it is a giant step into the unknown. The text of the bill doesn't even try to define what the standards will be, only that there will be standards and that those standards are not subject to the approval of voters, but instead a yet-to-be-named third party. Carte blanche has been given out by the legislature to this B-Labs corporation, three Stanford guys who are fully committed to Agenda 21 and globalism. In short, the governor has signed into law a bill that has the potential to give economic carte blanche to a group or organization that the public has neither vetted nor approved. To date, seven states have passed B Corp legislation. They include California, Hawaii, Maryland, New Jersey. What do they say about that, Governor? New York, Vermont, and Virginia. Already Colorado, Michigan, North Carolina, and Pennsylvania have legislation pending. Globalism is on the march. We have more on B Corporations at our website, freedomadvocates.org. In particular, Stephen Poole has written a comprehensive four-part article entitled Benefit Corporations, Expansion of the Public-Private Fascist State. Getting back to regionalism, let's take a look at AMBAG. That's the Association of Monterey Bay Area Governments. While ABAG is running the San Francisco Bay Area towns, AMBAG is conducting regional planning in the Monterey Bay Area. It is also a partner with ICLEI. The blueprint, this blueprint, includes the counties of Monterey, Santa Cruz, and San Benito. You can see here, Monterey Bay Area, a blueprint for sustainable growth and smart infrastructure. You can see the envisioning the towns they intend, light rail, no cars, stack and packed people, okay? Envisioning the Monterey Bay Area, a coordinated regional effort to shape and as a blueprint for sustainable growth. I mean, this stuff infects everything. Now let's take a look at a larger blueprint than that envisioned for this three-county area. It's called One Bay Area. Anyone here, I know there's a lot of Bay Area residents here. Any residents familiar with One Bay Area? And how many people from the Bay Area are here?
Monterey or?
No, San Francisco Bay Area. Now, One Bay Area is supported by four other regional governance apparatus. The Association of Bay Area Governments, okay, we got ABAG leading this one as well. The Federal Bay Area Metropolitan Transit Commission, the Bay Area Air Quality Management District, and the Bay Area Conservation and Development Commission. We saw the same four groups when we talked about FOCUS. All are extra constitutional parts of the federalized regional governmental apparatus. And all of them are scheming with ICLEI. And we wonder why America is falling. This plan is the Bay Area's primary Agenda 21 guidebook. It is made to look so benign. But you can come to understand the meaning of the terms and monitor these programs, and then you can ask yourself what it is you can do about it. You can see it takes the nine counties of the Bay Area, puts it under one governmental apparatus. One Bay Area, these are their words, equity is a central component of sustainability, along with the economy and environment, which together define the three E's of regional planning. Now, those are the three E's of globalism. Those are the three E's of Agenda 21. They say that 97% of all households will be accommodated in already urbanized areas. Being forced into smart growth, it sounds like. 630,000 new households will go into places that have been designated close to transit by local jurisdictions. What that means is you got to live close to the bus station or close to the light rail system, because you're not going to have cars, you're going to walk, and if you get any kind of mobility, it's going to be on public transportation. The globalist vision, just imagine, government-controlled housing, we've seen some pictures, we'll see some more, getting people out of their cars, comprehensive control over human action, while jamming people in like sardines so as to make them into a new man. Still, an old-fashioned serf. This is all in accordance with Agenda 21 sustainability policy and objectives. Now, don't stop with outing ICLEI. Don't stop when the Bay Area has One Bay Area program has been exposed. The globalist trap has been set wide and deep. We must keep our defenses up, and each of you are needed in that task. Let's take a look at an organization called Smart Growth Online. Supporting the development of vibrant, healthy communities is what it says up there. Well, Smart Growth, San Francisco's Transbay Transit Center Project epitomizes smart growth. You can just imagine stacked houses, with public transit out front, no cars other than for hire cars, no private cars. And this is what's being envisioned for the San Francisco Transbay Transit Center. Some comments on this project. we are coming together to create jobs and revitalize our economy, a new Grand Central Station of the West, said former Speaker Pelosi.
This project is the ultimate manifestation of smart growth.
I guess that's maybe the one clear, true statement that Lieutenant Governor has ever made.
In this final quote, one of the most, quote, transformational public transportation projects in the nation, it will soon be possible to get almost anywhere in the Golden State, says Secretary of Transportation Ray LaHood.
You see, the federal government has a plan for the Bay Area and transit centers, and they have plenty of partners to aid in the task. The Grand Boulevard Initiative. This one even shocked me. This is a collaboration of 19 cities, counties, and local and regional agencies united to improve the performance, safety, and aesthetics of El Camino Real. Starting at the northern Daly City city limit and ending near the Diridon Caltrain station in central San Jose. This is what they plan. Let's look at this picture a little bit. What we've got are the stack and pack units. What we've got is the public transportation systems. What we've got are autos for hire. That is not a suburban citizen's automobile. You see, everybody's off to work right now, apparently on their assignments. The streets aren't too full. There's a few people wandering around. But this is a totally different objective than what has been served for the last 100 years by the El Camino Real. Well, they probably have the bicycle path on the back side of the... So this is the vision of the Grand Boulevard Initiative. This is their words. Quote, a place for residents to work, live, shop, and play, creating links between communities that promote walking and public transit. Have you ever seen a chicken coop? This is how you house chickens. You live in stacked and packed housing, monitored by smart technology, walking to your job and living collectively as cogs in the new totalitarian order. This is what we're leaving to our children. You can see that our cities are becoming regionalized by federal operatives who are out to implement Agenda 21. We've talked about the El Camino Real Transit Corridor. Let's see if we can find something similar in Santa Cruz. This comes from the County of Santa Cruz, the Community Transit Corridor Plan. The general plan will be amended and the zoning code changes that will be supportive of the sustainable and transit-oriented land use patterns. And they've identified their first equivalent of the Grand Boulevard to be Soquel Avenue from Aptos past the village of Soquel. Eventually it will go on into the city of Santa Cruz. The Santa Cruz Planning Department has adopted the Sustainable Communities Strategy. The county receives state grant funding and is using redevelopment money to study and implement this strategy. We can see here, again, on a county document, task seven is to develop the final climate action strategy. What we are seeing is core evidence of the county's commitment to implement this ICLE program called Climate Communities. Well, this came out in 2008 from the Obama, I don't know if you can see it up here, the Obama-Biden transition team. And this document was produced by an outside party and submitted to the Obama-Biden transition project by our old friend, ICLE. We write on behalf of a growing coalition of elected leaders across America to share with you empowering local government climate action blueprint. Everything's a blueprint. Here we have climate communities. Build local support, local government support for the new HUD, Department of Transportation, EPA, Sustainable Communities Initiative. So if people want to tell you Agenda 21 is some kind of conspiracy, I mean, there are documents everywhere, all linking to the federal government. This is not the UN imposing this upon us. This is the federal government combined with the supervisors in the county of Santa Cruz and in the counties of every county in America. And until ordinary people catch on, we're going to continue to slide down. In Santa Cruz, we have this situation. We have a regional partnership under ICLEI's direction between the city, the county, and UCSC. Here we have Santa Cruz's own adoption of the Climate Action Compact in this partnership. This is a pure ICLEI program. It's used to tie up land use, to restrict energy use, to implement all the important ingredients of Agenda 21, and it comes to us via partnership like this. I'm not going to talk much about ecology action. It began here in Santa Cruz. It's now throughout the state. It's a behemoth in the pursuit of Agenda 21 activities. But I am going to use it to precipitate some discussion of the Land Trust of Santa Cruz recently released 25-year conservation blueprint. This word blueprint, all of a sudden in the last year, is the code word for everything Agenda 21. Well, here is the Conservation Lands Network for Santa Cruz County. So what does this map mean? This is the map that was referred to by Ecology Action. Well, the green areas are government-owned lands. The blue areas break into two categories. Basically, the blue area is the entire Santa Cruz mountain range. The dark blue, we'll call it wildlands. The light blue is the buffer zone. We have a list on the table of the partners of the Santa Cruz Land Trust, the most beautiful collection of public-private partnership you've ever seen. Those people who are characterized, I think, in this document as the scientific supporters for this conservation network. What it means is that if you're not a partner, you're going to end up off the lands. You know, foresters in this county have yet to figure out the threat that Agenda 21 is to them. And yet you go to this Conservation Lands Network, you'll find the two largest landowners in the county are part of this. You'll find that the public agencies from the local to the state to the federal are all part of this. You'll find that big business players in town are part of this. Okay? The loser is the independent landowner, and the loser is everybody who depends upon rural lands for the production of what it is we need to live. America is falling with plans like the Conservation Lands Network for Santa Cruz County. But this is just the tip of the iceberg. Because the Santa Cruz Lands Network for Santa Cruz County is an extension of the Conservation Lands Network for the San Francisco Bay Area. Here's the nine counties, the same blue and green, light blue for buffer zones and dark blue for hardcore wildlands, with green being those lands that are already under government control. You can see down here on the bottom, Santa Cruz is left out. This came out first, you know, but Santa Cruz makes the square here, if you will, and is important, but it didn't border on the Bay Area, so it's not part of the San Francisco Bay Area Conservation Network, but Santa Cruz was specifically segmented out to become part of this landmass planning dynamic. So who is the Conservation Lands Network? Well, they brag that many people have contributed. I'm sure that's true. People like to contribute because they think that buys them time against this enemy. I'm not sure that's true or not. But the partners include the Conservation Blueprint for Santa Cruz County. We looked at that. Focus Bay Area. We've looked at that. And I'm going to take a look at Golden Lands, Golden Opportunity. Looking through the list of partners, we need to understand that Golden Lands, Golden Opportunity is a program of the Bay Area Open Space Council. So what is the Bay Area Open Space Council? Well, its goal is to collectivize lands, that is to take them out of private property in order to implement the Wildlands Project. We see here that their programs start with Conservation Lands Network. Those are the two maps we've just looked at. And it includes this, again, Golden Lands, Golden Opportunity. So what is Golden Lands, Golden Opportunity? Well, it's a collaboration of Green Belt Alliance. See, the Green Belt phenomenon began here in Santa Cruz. Now it's spreading to the entire San Francisco Bay Area. And the Bay Area Open Space Council, in association with the same devils, the Association of Bay Area Governments, ABAG, and over 100 Bay Area organizations. You see, they've done their homework. They got all their chips lined up. You know, those of us who've been talking about this for a while can only say now, we better do something soon or forever hold our peace. Implementation of the Bay Area Open Space Initiative is coming. This NGO has identified over 1 million acres around the Bay that will be subjected to this initiative. Now is the time to organize property owners and American advocates. It is my expectation that the Bay Area Open Space is the project designed to take millions of Bay Area acres and put it into wildland status. Where I think this is leading us to is for a mass land grab of private land using acquisition by government or NGOs like the Nature Conservancy, the adoption of conservation easements, and regulatory prohibitions on use for everyone else. Land will ultimately be off limits to the citizens. That's the big picture. The Living Landscape Initiative is another dynamic that follows from all of this. We can see on this map, the blue again is the wildlands, and you see these little arrows. These are animal connectivity planning for the Bay Area and beyond. So these paths all have to be cleared for animal roamings. Okay? I've been hearing about this, and I've been to conferences about this coming from the, you know, from the green community for a decade now. This is all very well thought out and planned out by these people, and now they are in their final implementation stages. Now, the Living Landscape Initiative consists of a passionate group, this is their quote, a passionate group of 5 land conservation organizations in and around Silicon Valley, the Nature Conservancy, the Peninsula Open Space Trust, if you live on the peninsula, you know that's a big problem, the Save the Redwoods League, the Semper Virens Fund, and the Land Trust of Santa Cruz County. The Land Trust in Santa Cruz County is the biggest political issue to ever hit this community. And yet, the Santa Cruz Sentinel has never mentioned it. Here we see down at the bottom those five agencies. And, what we see here is just a whole idea of how to create and maintain sustainable living and landscape in the heart of coastal California. The collaboration has set a goal of, quote, protecting 80,000 acres within the next 20 years. All of Santa Cruz County falls within the Living Landscape Initiative area. So who protects? Let me ask a question. Who protects property better and derives more social benefits? The private landowner committed to private interests or the bureaucrat committed to the collective? It's a question we all have to begin to ask and answer. Because if we don't, we're going to end up as part of the collective ourselves. Now, before completing the land use element of Agenda 21, we need to take a look at an enforcement arm. INETS, the International Network for Environmental Compliance and Enforcement. So who brings that to us? Well, UNEP, the United Nations Environmental Protection Agency, the U.S. Environmental Protection Agency, and the World Bank. So these guys are not fly-by-nights. What do they plan to do? Well, they plan to establish a global network of environmental compliance and enforcement practitioners. They're seeking environmental compliance and enforcement, and they think that plays a fundamental role in building sustainable development. Enforcement is a huge aspect of Agenda 21, and the squeeze on rural landowners is going to become much worse. If these programs and initiatives proceed unabated, this is what you need to imagine. Communities surrounded by open space that ultimately you cannot access. In these communities, human action is monitored and controlled, and where new world human settlements or smart growth patterns are connected by public transportation corridors. Agenda 21 deceptively uses warm and fuzzy terms designed to lead people into believing they will live happily in regions comprised of sustainable communities or cool cities with climate action compacts, smart growth neighborhoods, walkable communities, and transit villages, all brought to you under a United Nations program courtesy of the federal executive branch, both Democrat and Republican, who have directed all cabinet-level departments and deployed its regional council termites to nationalize and localize Agenda 21 policy. This is why our cities are stuck in the mud. Real leaders are needed at City Hall and on the school board. We must defederalize our communities, and then we will have deglobalized our nation. Consider what has been illustrated here today. Regionalism, smart growth, public-private partnership, B corporations, the Wildlands Network, all components of sustainable ideology. Four key themes of Agenda 21 have emerged: regionalism, ICLEI, blueprints, and public-private partnership. In short, it's all about regionalism and Sovietization through regional councils and the fact that ICLEI is everywhere. The federal government, with its taxing policy and its conditions for return investment, its conditions for local return of those tax dollars we pay to DC, is able to exert dominant pressure on states and increasingly on local governments through sustainability pressure. The transformation to a global economic system is progressing in DC and every hometown. Is that all right with you? What are we leaving our children? Why are we abandoning the American pursuit of individual liberty and equal justice? As the dollar crashes around us, the Bay Area and all of California has been set up as a region to operate within and under a global order. With the transformation comes the end of the American experiment. Lost is the idea of private property. The path for Americans will become very hard if ordinary people do not reverse Agenda 21 implementation. Now, you can help reverse this process. The globalist course must be reversed soon, or it becomes too late. America's political leaders are not going to address this problem. We must defeat local implementation of Agenda 21, because if people do nothing, America becomes the land of the collected and home of the enslaved. So what can you do? First, think locally. Expose the regional Soviet system running your local government. That is where freedom will be won or lost. Go after and expose One Bay Area, ICLEI, ABAG, AMBAG, the Bay Area Open Space Council, and the Santa Cruz Land Trust for what they are: a massive fifth column leading Central California down the path to becoming an outpost of the new totalitarian order. Remember the essence of the mission: restore the principles set forth in the Declaration of Independence. Second, don't compromise the principles of freedom. fight smart growth and wildland projects in your area. And four, or three, look behind the green mask. So, what are our demands? The federal government is where the transformation is coming from. It is now everywhere, but especially in Central California. So take counteraction locally. Local proaction is our best strategy to stave off world government at this late date. First objective is to get the federal government out of your county and then out of California. This means having your city withdraw from the COG and the MPO. Otherwise, we've been Sovietized. So this means having your city. So once your city is withdrawn, you need to kick out of the county the U.S. Forest Service and the USDA, the Department of Interior, and the Department of Education. The second objective is to remove the globalists from all local governing boards and substitute them with people who understand the internationalist threat and its Agenda 21 action plan. Must terminate all contracts and contacts with ICLEI. Remove the ICLEI organization and all policy that resulted from the ICLEI association. Now, if we can understand your area's local Agenda 21 program, you can win back your town or neighborhood from Agenda 21's policies. Then we can move on to a broader area. Ultimately, people will combine with others working similarly around California. We must expunge sustainable development policy from our state's law and out of our state's bureaucracy. When enough leaders have recaptured their citizens' liberty, the federal government can be taken on effectively. Then we will have salvaged the American experience in individual liberty, equal justice, and the political recognition of every individual's unalienable rights. Long live the United States, and long live freedom-loving people everywhere. Thank you.
Let me point out what they're doing. What they're trying to do is get us focus our attention in the wrong place. The danger of communist China. Oh, they're over there planning to do us in, building up weapons. They even have one aircraft carrier now. And we know that they have all these nuclear bombs because we're told we have nuclear bombs. They have nuclear bombs. And oh, those Muslims, they want to come over here and take away our freedom. Ladies and gentlemen, these are all diversions. This whole thing is the diversion. The enemy is not in Moscow. The enemy is not in Beijing. The enemy is in Washington, D.C., in New York. You remember here, up here, who were these organizations? The World Bank. You remember the World Bank? Well, those of you who remember when I spoke, I've referred to the fact that six of the last 8 presidents of the World Bank, including the present one, came from the Trilateral Commission. If you've ever seen their logo, it's 3 sixes joined together by an upside-down broken cross. Now, we're going to take about 25 minutes. I didn't want to interrupt because that was a marvelous presentation. I wanted Michael to get through it. So we're going to take about a 20-minute break. And then we're going to have questions and answers. I'll ask all of the speakers to come up here, and we'll give you chairs. I need somebody. Mark, how would you like to take care? You'll have to turn this on. There's a little button at the bottom to press. If you want to ask a question, please come up, and we'll form a line. Maybe we could make a line over there, and people can come up. And you got 20 minutes. There's not going to be any rush. Go get some coffee and stretch your legs. And I want to introduce... Jim Fitzgerald. Is Jim Fitzgerald here, the fellow who's running for Congress? Just stand up there. Is it? Hello there. Do I have the name right?
Thank you for having me.
Okay, fine. And he's running for Congress up in the North Bay area.
John Fitzgerald, County. It used to be District 7, is now 11, the gerrymandered, like it is across the country.
John Fitzgerald, if you'd like to talk to him, we have a place back here for Ron Paul and great information. You can get copies of all of these DVDs, unique this time. They're going to be available. The talk that Michael just gave will be available. The talk that Rosalind and Betty have made is already available. My talk are available. You can get those, and we'll actually tape the hour-long panel we're going to have. So if you have questions, just think about it, and we'll have a line over here, and we'll go for an hour asking questions. Why don't you get up, stretch your legs, and look at the various material we have. Here. Oh, very, very simply. There's a button on the